Good morning, everyone. I'm out with my camera today in this beautiful marsh with a single goal in mind, that is to photograph birds in flight. Now, this can be quite the daunting task for new photographers or even more experienced advanced ones. It can be difficult just to find birds to photograph in the first place. It can be difficult to track them in your viewfinder as you photograph them. And it can be hard to know what settings on your camera are going to be best to photograph birds in flight. Today, I wanted to cover that third point. What settings are going to be best on your camera to photograph birds in flight, specifically in regards to your camera's autofocus modes and cases. So let's grab my camera today. We'll go through the different settings and decide what are going to be best to photograph the birds in flight out in this location that I'm at today. Now, I'm using a Canon, but these methods can be applied to virtually any camera when deciding what settings are going to be best to photograph birds in flight. So without further ado, let's just jump right into it. First, let's hit the basics really quickly. Your camera is going to have multiple options for your autofocus operation. In Canon, this is one shot and servo. One shot is great when you're photographing a stationary subject or scene. You focus, your focus is locked, and you can fire away. Honestly, I never use this option when photographing wildlife. Well, because wildlife likes to move. So instead I use servo, which is designed for continued focus on a moving subject. Next, you have your autofocus point selection. Each model of camera is a little different, but these are essentially at which points you're telling your camera to look for something to focus on. The larger the area is that you select, the harder and longer your camera is going to have to work to find what to focus on. While photographing stationary birds, I stick to the spot autofocus. This will give me the finest point to tell the camera what I want to focus on. But once that bird starts to move, it becomes nearly impossible to keep that one little autofocus point right on the bird's eye, so we need to expand our focus point selection a little bit. I personally like to use the expanded 5-point autofocus. If you're still having a difficult time sticking to your subject, try the 9-point autofocus and see how that works for you. Both of these options expand your focus area and make it a lot easier to keep at least one of those points on the subject that you're photographing while it's in flight. Many cameras these days have the ability to focus on an animal's eye and track it wherever it goes. This works especially well with birds and is a fantastic option if you have it available. If not, that's totally fine. Trust me, you don't need it to photograph birds in flight. Even though my camera has it available, I choose not to use it sometimes depending on the subject that I'm photographing or just simply to stay practiced in using those autofocus points as I photograph birds in flight. All right, let's hop into the settings that I really wanted to touch on today. Those are your camera's different autofocus cases that you can set and adjust. If there's one group of settings that I think many photographers set once and then forget to change or adjust afterwards, it's this group of settings. And honestly, that might be why you're missing the shot. So let's hop into my camera and I'll share with you some recent examples of when I needed to adjust these various settings. The first case on the Canon R5 is a very good, versatile option. It even says on the camera, this can be used for a wide variety of scenarios. I usually use case number one in more basic scenarios when photographing birds in flight. For instance, if I have a bird flying by me at a very even pace and there's no obstacles in the way of that bird, that's when I really like to use case number one and it does a fantastic job. It can be used in a wider variety of scenarios, but much like your camera's autofocus point selection, when you expand that selection to cover a larger area, it can take your camera just a little bit longer for it to figure out what you're wanting to focus on, and it'll give you the best results that it can, but those may not be the results that you want. I believe the same thing applies to case number one. It can cover a wider variety of scenarios, but again, your camera's just trying to figure out what you want to see as the photographer, and it'll give you the best results that it can. But again, those may not be the results that you want. This brings me to case number two. Case two is designed to track a subject while ignoring possible obstructions. This is the case I use in a forest setting or other chaotic landscape or setting. Recently, while spending time with great gray owls, I was able to use this case to make sure my camera didn't try to refocus every time an owl would disappear behind a tree for a second, only to reappear on the other side. This case is designed to hold that focus plane and pick up focus on your subject again once free of the obstacle. So using my previous example, if I'm setting out into the forest to photograph owls or some other type of bird, I'm probably going to pick case 2. Now let's dive a little bit further into this. Once I've selected case 2, I can go in and adjust my tracking sensitivity. The tracking sensitivity has a similar function in each of these cases in that decreasing the dial holds focus on your subject for longer, and increasing the dial allows you to switch focus to a new subject more quickly. In case 2, for instance, by decreasing the dial on the tracking sensitivity, you're telling your camera to hold focus on the owl as it flies behind the tree, only to come out the other side. If you were to increase the dial on the tracking sensitivity, you're telling your camera to more quickly focus on any obstacles that come in between your camera and the subject that you're photographing. So when using this case, I generally decrease the dial all the way to maintain focus on the subject that I'm photographing if any obstacles come in between my camera and that subject. The next meter is acceleration deceleration tracking. You can make adjustments to this meter based upon how quickly or consistently your subject is moving. The overall function of this setting is pretty uniform across all these different cases, so we're actually going to come back to this setting in just a minute. Let's move on to case 3. This case will prioritize quickly focusing on subjects that suddenly appear in your focus points. The past few days I've been photographing American dippers. These are smaller birds that are incredibly quick and somewhat unique in that they dive into moving water in search of food. While photographing them, I'm not too worried about many obstacles getting in between the dippers and my camera. The challenge is focusing on them quickly as they come out of the water and appear on a rock or ice in the river. These are quick and somewhat random birds, and this case is perfect for subjects like that. When setting the tracking sensitivity meter in this case, by decreasing the dial, you'll slow down how fast the camera will be able to acquire new focus on a subject entering your focus points. By increasing the dial, you're speeding up how fast you'll be able to acquire focus on that subject. So in the case with dippers or other small birds flying around that are more sporadic and random and you have to find them and focus on them quickly, I'm going to increase the tracking sensitivity meter. Let's take a look at case 4. Case 4 should be used when a bird suddenly changes speed while flying. If a bird's simply going from point A to point B, they generally do so at a pretty consistent speed. But this is a case that I actually use a lot in my birds in flight photography. So let's look at an example of when a bird might change speed while flying. Recently, while photographing birds in Florida, I was watching these pelicans and I noticed that they would fly over the water looking for fish below. Suddenly, when they spotted some, they would hit the brakes in midair, turn on their sides, and dive into the water. This is a perfect scenario of when to use this case. I was able to make the changes in my camera and come away with some pretty fun images. Just as with previous cases, if you decrease the dial on the tracking sensitivity, you're telling your camera to hold focus on your subject for longer. So if you're photographing a bird and it unexpectedly dives and you accidentally move off of it for a second, you're giving yourself time to get back on it and continue to photograph it without losing focus on that subject. By increasing the dial, your camera is going to look for a new subject to focus on more quickly, which is not what I want in this case, so I'm going to decrease the dial on this one. Now let's finally touch on the acceleration deceleration meter and how I determine where to set this at. As with all of these autofocus cases and various settings that we've talked about today, they're very much situational and scenario based. There's not simply a perfect combination of settings that you can use. You need to be able to analyze the subject that you're photographing, its behavior, or the behavior you're hoping to see, and make the appropriate adjustments on your settings. The purpose of the acceleration deceleration tracking is to allow you to tell the camera how sporadic or how consistent your subject is moving. I've seen some gulls out here flying today as I've been filming this video, and they've been doing so at a relatively consistent speed. So as I go out to photograph them today, I'm going to leave this meter in the neutral position. Alternatively, I've also seen some harriers out here today, and if you've ever seen harriers fly around, they like to speed up and slow down as they fly. So as I go out to photograph them, I'm going to select what case I think is going to be best to photograph them on, go to the acceleration deceleration meter, and actually increase this. By doing so, I'm telling the camera that the subject that I'm photographing is more inconsistent in their speed. I really need to reiterate that there's no perfect combination for birds and flight photography. For best results, you really need to analyze the subject that you're photographing, the behavior that you're seeing or hoping to see, what setting you're in, and make the appropriate adjustments from there. I know that this can seem overwhelming, but it's okay. The best way to master this is to just get out with your camera, practice, and have fun. Regularly photograph similar scenarios and make adjustments as you review the results. You'll get the hang of it quicker than you think, and pretty soon it'll just become second nature. Many people just look up online, what are the best settings for birds in flight photography? And they plug the first thing that they find into their camera and just hope for the best. I guarantee you, if you spend some time actually familiarizing yourself with your camera, with its settings and what those settings are actually intended to do, and then get out into the field and put all that into practice, you'll see a drastic increase in the overall quality of your images and your overall hit rate when you go out to actually photograph birds in flight. I'd like to hear from you. Are there certain scenarios or even a specific species of bird where you prefer to use one group of settings over another while photographing those birds in flight? I love learning together here as a group, so let us know what you think down in the comments below. I hope this video has been informative to you, and I hope that it helps you in your birds in flight photography. Again, I'd love to hear what you have to think. Thank you so much for following along this week. I always appreciate the support and feedback that you guys give me. Until next week, we'll see you next time. Thank you.